Hey, can you see the screen?
Yes, and Roberto, just that we get on the record, you are good who is as recording that, right?
Yes, absolutely.
Thank you.
So, hello everyone. My name is Roberto Cavicchioli, and I'm a postdoctoral researcher from the High Performance Real-Time Lab of the University of Modern Energy Media. Together with my colleagues, we investigate a way to fine-grain control the memory accesses from different actors within heterogeneous system on a chip to keep the predictability that a prime scheme can achieve while increasing the system performance. Firstly, I will show the capabilities of modern design of heterogeneous system on chip. Then I will explain what the predictable execution model is and how it is usually applied to embedded system to grant predictability and freedom from interference. I will describe what our injection approach is and how it is implemented. I will further depict our benchmark methodology and present the result that we obtained. Finally, I will revise the conclusion that our team has reached and propose some future application of this work. As a background, most modern multi-core SoC design leverage heterogeneity at different levels to obtain maximum performance on average. Usually, the multi-core host processor is coupled to some type of acceleration fabric, such as GPGPUs, DSPs, or programmable logic like FPGA. For energy efficiency, the design of the CPU itself is typically heterogeneous, with a number of compute clusters sharing interconnection and memory resources. Globally, these heterogeneous clusters and other acceleration devices share the last level cache or the main system memory. This system must sustain tremendous bandwidth to the main memory to satisfy requests coming from these many actors, but still suffering the contention between the different computing engines. Predictable execution model, or PREM, was originally proposed in the context of single-core CPU to provide robustness to memory access interference from I/O devices, and was later extended to avoid inter-core interference in multi-core CPUs. PREM assumes that tasks are split into memory and compute phases, with all the shared memory access in the memory phase. This allows a system designer to tightly bound memory access latencies, leading to shorter worst-case execution time and ultimately less pessimism in traditional timing and schedulability analysis. While this greatly reduced VSAT pessimism, the very method for canceling interference entails one of the main drawbacks of PREM. Executing only one memory phase at a time implies severe underutilization of the shared memory bandwidth in most cases. For example, in this table, we tested the effect of inter-core bandwidth sharing on a variety of commercial heterogeneous SoCs, highlighting the portion of the total SoC bandwidth that is used by the CPU cores. We used the BVMEM benchmark from the LMBench suite to measure the maximum bandwidth request generated by a single CPU core here, and the maximum aggregated bandwidth requested by all the cores inside of the CPU complex. For each of the tested SoC, where a total nominal bandwidth value is available and shown in the rightmost column, the comparison with the aggregated CPU bandwidth shows that a significant share of it is reserved to other devices, such as the accelerators. Even though the bandwidth request in general does not grow up linearly with the number of cores, is it evident that a single CPU core only consumes a fraction of the bandwidth budget allocated to the CPU complex? In this scenario, the one core at a time memory arbitration model implied by PREM is bound to poorly fit the increasing gap in bandwidth reservation. We know from literature that PREM could be enhanced with techniques to admit more than one task at a time to access memory, such as K-PREM, that allow K tasks on different cores to access memory concurrently, but in an uncontrolled way, and MemGuard that monitors the access from each core at a certain granularity, but it manages cores and not tasks. Our experience has shown that for such techniques to be successful, the rate at which the new task injects its own transaction should be strictly controlled in a fine-grained manner. We call this technique controlled memory transaction injection, proposing a synthetic benchmark that allows evaluating this concept by a thorough characterization of the system. So, for controlled injection, we define the following. Since we have shown that one core cannot fully exploit the bandwidth that modern heterogeneous SoC have, we allow other clients to request only a fraction of their available bandwidth, so to keep busy the memory controller unaffecting the main task. In this chart on the left, we can see that core zero requesting memory to the memory controller and then waiting, since it can manage only that much bandwidth, and the memory controller is very efficient in serving its requests. On the right, we show that a state in which core 1 and core 2 are granted some memory requests in red and yellow that are far below the maximum bandwidth that they can request. But as a result, we obtain a higher utilization at memory controller level. The trickiest part here is to define the correct amount of data that core 1 and core 2 should be allowed to request without increasing the latency experienced by core 0. We need, therefore, to characterize our system. In our work, we designed our benchmark, which is called Membench. The first thing that we need to be able to control is the type of access pattern that our benchmark generates. Traditionally, sequential and random patterns are adopted for this type of bandwidth and latency measurement. In most modern SoCs, we found that cache prefetcher, DRAM row buffer, and other hardware blocks target improving the average cache performance. In order somehow to bypass this mechanism, we implemented a simple pointer walk over a portion of a statically pre-allocated large array composed of data structures. Each of one is a pointer to the next address to read or write, and some padding to fill the remainder of a whole L2 cache value. We then parameterized our tests by setting the size of the array to read with sideman, and the actual number of cache lines to be accessed using the parameter and lines. The latter is the one that controls the size of the memory phase, which in our work we assume to be the size of the L2 cache divided by the number of cores that we have in the cluster. But we have also to define the injection rate, because to evaluate the benefit of the controlled injection, as well as to assess the capability of controlling it at a fine granularity, we extended Membench with two more parameters. Number of cache lines that the task can read before being self-throttled, and the number of cycles that task will be throttled before reading again. Therefore, L and C, that are defined here, define the duty cycle of the memory requests issued by the task that is performing the controlled injection. In our experimental evaluation, we call load intensity the ratio between the number of cache lines and the number of throttling cycles. The load intensity affects different ways the injection rate, depending on the type of access pattern that it can perform. For our benchmarking, we have selected the NVIDIA Jetson TX2 board as our reference SoC because it's widely available and features also a GPU accelerator governed by a Genius processor. It is organized in two different compute clusters, a quad-core ARM V8 Cortex-A57, and a dual-core ARMv8 compliant Denver processor, which is an NVIDIA proprietary design. We also have the Pascal GPU accelerator as well. Each of the six cores integrates a 32 KB L1 data cache and 48 KB L1 instruction cache. Furthermore, each cluster features a 2 MB L2 cache shared among its logical cores. The main memory is 8 GB LPDDR4 120 bits DRAM, with a total bandwidth of 59.7 GB per second, needed to sustain requests coming from the two CPU clusters and the GPU accelerator. Our target is to assess the benefit of the fine-grained controlled injection system under the most pessimistic condition. To model such condition, we model the task set as follows. Task under test, UT, is representative of the prem task currently allowed to access the main memory, so it requests full bandwidth available. The task read once the amount of data decided by the generation policy, and this is typically the whole cache. The rest of the task, which in a standard prem system would be idle because it is one core at a time, is executing, and they are allowed to inject their own memory transaction at varying rates, acting as interfering task, IF. To model the worst case interference that the EIF task would generate, we execute them for the whole time that the under-task test is running. Specifically, if the tasks, interfering tasks start the execution before we launch the under-test task and complete execution after that under-test task has terminated. Background, the GPU is constantly reading at full speed for the whole duration of the test, always because we want to analyze the worst-case scenario. And also to analyze all the possible corner cases, we consider various combinations of access paths. since we are interested in the different kind of access that can stress the memory controller. Usually, a task can access memory in a sequential way, so with a constant stride between accesses, or in a randomic way, so the stride is not known a priori. We then couple all possible combinations of these patterns, such as sequential-sequential, sequential-randomic, randomic-sequential, and randomic-randomic. Please consider that even if prem compilers usually try hard to generate only sequential patterns for the memory phases, random patterns are unavoidable in certain applications. Considering the cluster-based nature of the target hardware, that we conduct our experiments in three settings: inside the Cortex-A57 CPU cluster, inside the Denver CPU cluster, and across the two compute clusters. Now, the results. In the first step, we consider a single under-test task, which represents the task that a regular prem scheme will grant exclusive access to memory. On top of that, we explore the effect of allowing controlled injection by interfering tasks, mapped on the remaining core from the same compute cluster, to ensure that each task is pinned to a different core. For this, we vary with exponential spacing the load intensity from near zero to 100%. The Cortex-A57 core reads memory chunks of 512 kilobytes. The plots show the load intensity on the bottom x-axis, and the corresponding injection rate of a single interfering task on the top axis. This metric is computed as the bandwidth requested by an interfering task for a particular load intensity, normalized by the maximum bandwidth that the same interfering task can request from the same experiment. The plot shows the measuring bandwidth on the left y-axis and the latency increase on the right y-axis. The stacked area plots show the breakdown of the total utilized bandwidth, and by the under-test task in darker, and by interfering task in lighter color. The plot also highlights the measured max bandwidth here that the four ARM cores can cumulatively request when generating memory transaction at full throttle. The black line with yellow markers show the increase in execution time of the memory phase experienced by the under-test task, while interfering tasks are injecting extra memory transactions at increasing rates. More specifically, these values represent the latency of the test normalized to the baseline execution latency in absence of interference. If we focus then only on bandwidth, in all these plots, it seems that a significant portion of the available bandwidth can be utilized by the controlled injection. By combining the information from the latency curve that measures the increased latency and the bandwidth areas, it is possible to identify a sweet spot in which each traffic pattern combination we can gain the most. Focusing here on the left side, we see that the cumulative bandwidth request from all the Cortex-A57 reaches around 6 gigabytes per second, while a single core utilizes 66% of that maximum bandwidth. If we focus on the latency curve, we notice that when we use 0.8% load, so corresponding to a 30% of injection rate, we perturb the execution time of the under-test task only by 55%, while in this case, the injection allows us to reach 81% of the maximum sequential bandwidth, with virtually no impact on the execution time of the under-test task. When the interfering task workload instead is of type randomic on the right-hand side, we have virtually no impact on even at 100% when of controlled injection is allowed. This brings a 37% increase in bandwidth usage while reaching 72% of the maximum sequential bandwidth. If we go then move to the case in which the under-test task is randomic, then if the interfering task is sequential, we see that the controlled injection has a tremendous effect because we can really exploit the bandwidth usage. We need to tolerate increasing the execution time of the under-test task, varying from one system to another. But you can see that even with 100% injection rate, the latency never exceeds 17%. In this case, we observe a staggering 13,000% increase in bandwidth usage, reaching 93% of the maximum sequential bandwidth. If we want still to take a more conservative 10% as maximum tolerated increase in latency, we can still achieve here the load intensity of 1.5%, the 600% increase in bandwidth usage. Finally, when both the under test and the interfering test task are of type randomic, we see that the bandwidth request can be fully summed up, increasing bandwidth usage by 300% without impacting the execution time of the under test task. The benefits of the controlled injection in the Denver cluster are even more pronounced, as one single Denver core roughly uses half the available bandwidth for the cluster, as can be seen in the Dev plot. Although the number are slightly less stable in this experiment, it can be seen that even when the injection rate reaches 100%, the increase in the latency of the under test task stays around 10%. The bandwidth usage reaches full efficiency as it gets doubled. Similarly to the Cortex-A57, there is not a lot to be gained when the interfering task is ultra-randomic and then the test task is sequential, as the bandwidth generated by the Randmax pattern is an order of magnitude smaller than the sequential from the Denver core. Still, controlled injection can be applied full throttle without disturbing the under test task. When the under task is randomic, there is always to gain from controlled injection. If the interfering task is sequential, we increase bandwidth usage by 460%, while keeping latency increased below 10%. Yeah. When the interfering task is of type randomic, we can double the bandwidth usage without impacting the under test task at all. This figure shows the result for our last experiment, where an ARM core and an Ender core both run an under test task, while the remaining cores from both clusters run interfering tasks. At system level, the benefits of the controlled injection already seen within each cluster are consolidated, but for the sequential under test task, then the randomic under test task. But how we practically realize this scheme? Implementing controlled injection requires design choices that are inherently tied not only to the specific platform real-time requirements, but also to the particular software stack that we are interested on. Hence, since it will be impossible to provide a definitive reference implementation, we go through some important points. Firstly, we need to find which is the limit of the injection rate, since bandwidth injection on a prem-like setup needs to be bounded to preserve the memory access determinants. We could choose a safe approach, meaning the greatest injection load intensity such that our latency is slower than a set threshold, and capping every interfering task with that parameter. Although it produces experimental guarantees, this approach might be considered extensive or rigid. On the other hand, if a hot measurement of the latest impact can be performed online, then such information can be fed to a suitable adaptive algorithm, which dynamically increases or reduces the injection rate until reaching an oscillation around the optimal value. Secondly, we need to implement the injection itself. A fine-grained control can be achieved using a suitable prime compiler that can include idle instruction sequences within the memory phases, as we have done in our synthetic benchmark. In this case, the control of the injection rate is defined as possible, but we need all tasks to be rebuilt on the custom compiler. To achieve instead of transparent control without the need of recompiling our task, a centralized and secure injection control mechanism can be integrated in an underlying system layer software, such as MapAdvisor, to periodically throttle an injected task and possibly measure the impacted latency. Feasibility of this approach has been already proven from our research group using the hypervisor JLouse on NVIDIA TX2. In this work, we presented how, with various types of workload, is it possible to exploit the available bandwidth of heterogeneous system-on-chip in a more efficient way than the canonical prem arbitration. The proposed control injection technique allows, in most practical cases, to get close to the maximum available bandwidth without significantly impacting the latency of the original prem task. As part of our future work, we envision the development of a practical controlled injection scheme built on top of existing prime implementation that consider both the CPU and the GPU of heterogeneous SoCs. And control injection also paves the way to new, more effective prime-based scheduling algorithms. We are currently evaluating scheduling policies where both the under test and the interfering task are slowed down by the same factor, rather than leaving full bandwidth to a core and allowing the others to inject small amount of requests. Thank you very much for your attention.
Questions to Roberto? What do you see are the next steps here, Roberto?
Well, I, more or less, as I already told, the idea is to deploy a compiler that can be able to inject the knob cycles, the idle cycles inside the memory phases of the task in an autonomous way. And maybe with the help of something at the system level, a way to communicate within each task to be able to set what are the parameters of the controlled injection. So that, to say that we have at a certain point in time some high priority task that needs a lot of bandwidth to and to ensure that all of the other tasks doesn't interfere too much with him, so we can set from the operative system level the parameters L and C dynamically, so to be able to have this kind of system already running and able to provide all of this capability of predictability and freedom from interference.
Yeah, it makes good sense. It's interesting to see that, you know, like isolation and interference is a big theme this year. And I personally think that this is only going to become more and more important, because as the hardware becomes more sophisticated and therefore more complex, the chances for interference increase, right? So this whole area, I think it's very relevant moving forward.
Yeah, absolutely, because we are increasing the number of cores in our CPU and the number of cores in the GPU. So every time we will expect to have more and more interference within the memory. So,
yeah, I think the insight of looking at tasks who is different characteristics, right? It was also Yun Sung was talking about, you know, the low latency versus the background tasks. Really provides an interesting avenue to try to address the problem. Because in the end of the day, when resources are shared and you need to create some isolation, there is someone who is going to lose, right? And having a right mix of low latency tasks and what Yun Sung was talking, background tasks, enables us to be able to do something and create some expectations to the different tasks classes.
Yes, absolutely. The idea here is to allow more or less the background task to work, but not interfering with the low latency one, to the high priority one. And that's more or less it.
All right. Any other questions? All right. Grazie, Roberto. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Let me stop recording.